Are you ready to manage your work and personal world better to live a fulfilling, productive life? Then you've come to the right place. Productivity Cast, the weekly show about all things productivity. Here are your hosts, Ray Sidney Smith and Augusto Pinaud, with Francis Wade and Art Gelwicks.
Welcome back, everybody, to Productivity Cast, the weekly show of all things personal productivity. This is episode 22, and I'm Ray Sidney Smith here with Augusto Pinaud, Francis Wade, and last but not least, Art Gelwicks. How's it going, gentlemen?
Doing well. Doing really well.
I am excited about this episode because we get to kvetch a little bit of Yiddish to start the morning. But we get to talk about productivity pet peeves. And what we're going to do today on this cast is to talk about really the issues that cause us the most strife when it comes to interacting and engaging with others. And then we will talk about the solutions. What are the things that actually help solve these issues? What can mitigate these kinds of pet peeves? And it will help, hopefully, you, the listeners, start to make a list of the things that actually annoy you. Pet peeves are obviously something that annoys a person, and in this case, probably annoys you. And small interventions can actually really help solve a lot of these problems. What we're going to each do is sort of go round robin and talk about each of our pet peeves in the time that we have for this recording. So let's get started.
All right. I'll start with the working from least to greatest. And trust me, I got lots of them, but this is least out of the five. For me, the one that I trip over all the time is this concept of the next big thing. You see a press release, you see a news article, you see something show up in your feed reader, it talks about the next great productivity tool that is out there, next product or great solution that's out there. And all of a sudden, everybody takes their eye off the ball for what they're trying to do. A good portion of people run over and say, oh yeah, I'm going to start trying that now. That sounds great. You know, and it's like when somebody comes by with the dessert cart. Everything looks great until you give it a try, and 2 hours later, you feel like a beached whale. You have to have that level of focus to say, I'll evaluate it. I'll give it some evaluation time. Maybe I'll tinker with it a little, but don't abandon the system you have for the next big thing. That's just, it's completely unproductive, and it's almost foolish at times because you're going to derail yourself in both areas because now your existing system is going to fall apart for a while, and guaranteed, you're not going to successfully implement this new system in such a short period of time. So that's my number five, is the, quote, next big thing.
We're not developing the discerning powers of discernment, let's call it that, to figure out what change we need to use to implement next. Maybe about four or five episodes ago, we talked about the business of trying to sift through all of the different productivity ideas that every single day. And also, you know, how do you respond to the fact that you have a problem and you need to find a solution? So we're not good at, as one of my peeves, we're not good at developing the skill of figuring out which improvement to implement next. We bounce around from buying a new device to picking up a new book to reading a blog post to listening to a podcast. Most people are bouncing around without a clear roadmap of the best way to proceed. So they have the experience that Art described, which is that the next new shiny thing with the right advertisement, the right colors, the right use of the latest technology is the one that grabs the attention. And I think that's really detrimental to most professionals.
It would be really great, Francis, if there was actually an assessment that was a little bit more tailored to what you are talking about here, which is...
Well, so happens.
Really? There is one, huh?
I don't like advertising too much. But in my book, I have and my training, I have a 54-point assessment that goes into lots of sub-skills and allows the user or the reader or the learner to compare their current skills against best in class. So they come away with a snapshot that's a profile of their current skills. And as they learn the skill I'm teaching, they do an immediate assessment and then come up with an immediate plan. So I didn't want to, you know, go all the way out, but that is what my work is all about pretty much.
You know, my first pet peeve is not writing things down or write in a way that you know out of the bat it's not going to work. I spend a lot of time dealing with people, and there is a lot of information that needs to pass one way and the other, needs to be tracked. And it is incredible for me in this day and age that people do not write things down. And people are sitting there in the meeting and, oh, yeah, I will do that. And you are looking at these people, and they are still trusting that their brain is going to work for them, and it's going to allow them to recall the details of this stuff. And it may be me and only me, but my mind has never worked like that. And what happened is the way I recall the stuff, it's never how I meant to be or how it meant to be recalled when I should have written down.
I have a rule at my office, which is that no one is allowed to come into my office without paper and pen in hand. And I've had that rule for many, many years. And the other rule, which is that if there is a problem, that they are to come into my office with potential solutions and with the understanding that I might say no to all of those solutions, but that the goal is for them to think. The exercise is to think about how one might resolve these issues without me. And so I'm right there with you, Augusto. I think that everyone should always have paper and pen in hand. It's really important at the office or in any environment where, you know, you might be working, to be able to capture actions, capture ideas, and be prepared for this, for your memory failing you. Francis?
Sure. Mine is the oversimplification that guys like us sort of engage in sometimes when we offer solutions to the public. And we say them in such a way that we lead people to think that one size fits all, and that all they need to do is just pretty much do what we do and just implement the following habits and practices and use the following tool. And there's a lot, it's just not true. But the person who is new to the field of productivity will read and believe that, yeah, okay, that's all I have to do. That's easy. And it's just not true. It's not true for many, many reasons. One of them has to do with the style that you talked about before. But one also has to do with the scaling problem that I've written about, which is that each particular combination of practices, habits, and tools is ideal for a particular volume of tasks. And once the number of tasks goes above a certain level, that tool or that approach no longer works. So, for example, memory works fine when you're 10 years old, for most people. And somewhere in your teens, if you're someone who's ambitious and hardworking and sort of very diligent, you start to create more tasks than your memory can manage. And you have to move to a substitute. But we're not taught that. People don't know that. It's pretty obvious in hindsight. And most adults know it. But what we don't realize is that the same rule of non-scalability applies all the way throughout our career. And we always need to be cognizant that our current level is only as good as the number of tasks that we're trying to manage. And as soon as that number goes up, we need to be seeking the next level. So that's my pet peeve. And I've written about it, and I'll give you the links as to what I think the progression, natural progression, given the technology that we have available today, happens to look like.
You remind me of my reminiscing about my primary school and secondary school years. I always say to people that those were the absolute best, most productive years of my life, in a way, because I had abject focus. I didn't have to think about a mortgage. I didn't have to think about where I had to be and what city for work and all of those things. It was all of the stability of saying, okay, my one job, my one goal, my only thing that I needed to focus on was school. And luckily, you know, my parents allowed and gave me that space to be able to really focus on my education. And I utilized it with utter focus.
Same here. I was single focused all the way through school, very much the same way.
And I look for ways in which to replicate that now today, and it's very difficult. And so I really do understand where people come from, the sense of you know, bifurcated focus, or even, you know, trifurcated focus in that sense, you know, with work, home life, and personal development, and wanting to be better. So it's a very, very understandable pet peeve that we all struggle with. And I think it's important to be able to figure out how to manage that well.
I don't want anybody to think that you have to be completely single focused through your youth to be able to have success with this, because I was totally the opposite. I was fragmented on every path, ran down every rabbit hole that interested me. And the commonality that developed was learning internally. I didn't realize it at the time, but developing internal systems to try, evaluate, and quantify whether or not something was going to work for me, or I enjoyed something, or something had a potential for me, and then be able to move on to the next thing. So I think people listening to this need to understand that there isn't just one particular way. If you're that type of person who's constantly sticking your fingers into various things, that's okay too. There are methods and there are approaches to how you can use productivity solutions to work that way as well.
Agreed. My first productivity pet peeve is something that we all actually do to some extent, and this comes from not knowing other people. And this is not what I call not understanding people's working styles. And so some of this is actually work that came to my attention from Dr. Tony Alessandro, and he wrote the book The Platinum Rule. And there has always been an understanding of personality styles, and this idea of, he calls the Platinum Rule, and in years prior to him, I actually called it the Diamond Rule, which is do unto others as they would have done unto themselves, right? So the Golden Rule, of course, is do unto others as you would have done unto you. And that's the kind of selfish way to look at it, because most people want things done the way they want them done to themselves, not the way in which someone else would do it to them. So it's a perspective that creates a lot of conflict. And so in life, Dr. Alessandro basically says there are four different styles, very similar to many of the other personality style indicators that are out there. He uses relator, socializer, thinker, and director. And I'll just give a very basic example. A director is somebody who shoots from the hip. They want bullet points and they want to make a decision. Well, if you're a thinker, if you're highly analytical and you're used to taking all of the information down, digesting that information, and then slowly coming to a decision, well, if you have a director as your supervisor or as your colleague, and they just want to throw a bunch of bullet points at you and have you make a decision, well, you're going to shut down and there's going to be conflict there. Well, if you learned that the thinker colleague or thinker subordinate needs some more information, that's going to help you bridge that gap and reduce the friction and also get a better decision out of your thinker. So if you can figure out other people's working styles, you reduce a lot of the inefficiencies that happen and the lack of effectiveness, really, that happen in organizations today. So start to think about the way in which you see other people operating and then work with them. You know, if somebody's a socializer in Dr. Alessandro's work, then guess what? They need you to talk it out with them. They need to be able to banter and get those things working in terms of the communal understanding. And once they've been able to do that, once they've been able to talk it out, they'll be able to come to a decision. So learn the material, and I'll put a link to the Platinum Rule in the show notes so that people can deep dive into this information if they'd like to.
Okay, number two on my list actually spins, or number four, spins back to a couple of things we were talking about a little bit earlier with the idea of capturing things and always showing up to meetings with notebooks and things like that. And that's the dichotomy between the analog world and the digital world. The people who show up at a meeting with paper and pencil and the people who show up with a laptop or their smartphone. It drives me bonkers that there's a battle between the two, because they're different types of personalities. And honestly, I use both. Sitting right here on this call, I've got a laptop that I'm taking notes on, and I have a notebook I'm taking notes in.
Ditto.
There is no evidence whatsoever that I find quantifiable or qualifiable that says that one is clearly superior to the other. It has to go with, one, the working environment you're in, the type of person you are, the type of information you're trying to capture. All of that comes into play. So to waste time having the debate that notebooks are better than laptops, or laptops are better than notebooks, don't bother. Just move on. Pick something that works for you and complements your system in a way that you're going to be able to capture information, like Augusto said, You're going to be able to process that information into your system, and you're going to be able to report on it. I mean, you'll hear me use the analogy all the time that your system is basically CPR. It's the life of your system, and it's capture, process, and report. Well, whatever tool you use has to fit into that methodology. So, you know, it just drives me bonkers when people get into that battle. Oh, no, you should use a paper notebook, or you should always take things down on a laptop because it's more efficient. You know what? Doesn't matter. If you're getting the job done, great.
My second one is the lack of a list of what I call a waiting form. So it is interesting to me, and has always been, how people get to talk to you or somebody else, and they go into that office and bring whatever is the hot potato at the time. They have a sack of potatoes, but they went in to talk, interrupt, or meet, and then bring a potato. That means most of the times they need to come into that same environment 2 or 3 or 7 or 10 times a day to discuss the other potatoes. It is, in the GTD world, is called an agenda. You can call it a waiting for. You can call it a list of issues. Doesn't matter how you call it. But if I am going to have to call Art, for example, and I have an item that I want to discuss with Art, why not bring a list of every item I need to cover with Art? That way we can use that time as effective as possible. Are you going to use that list every time? No, there are moments the only right thing to do is go into the hot big potato. But in many cases, I will say most of them, it gives you an opportunity to knuckle 2 or 3 things out of the list, or at least bring them back to the attention. And hey, we need to still do something about this. And it is for me really incredible how little that resource is used. So instead of that, you go and interrupt that person 5 to 7 times. You know, you are in a meeting where there is 3 or 4 people, the meeting is ending, you know that person will be there and his brain is not yet engaged into the next thing. Why not pull that list and say, hey, Art, before you leave, why we don't look into these couple of things right now and maybe, you know, see where we are with them. So I would love for people to be able to use or to have that kind of list more often instead of going into 3, 4, 5 meetings on the topic, on each topic.
Well, I will tack my second pet peeve onto this for you, Augusto, because I am of the same sort in terms of coming to a meeting and either having no reason for a meeting and certainly no agenda for a meeting. So whereas yours is different, I understand that. I believe that everyone should have an agenda for every meeting and you should have a reason for the meeting, because so many times, you know, in years past, I would get requests for meetings and I would presume the person had a reason for meeting with me and would present me with an agenda beforehand. And it doesn't have to be a formalized agenda. You know, you can put in the calendar event description, you know, in the notes of the calendar event, even the outline of the agenda. I don't need you to, you know, type up a document and PDF it and send it to me necessarily. You know, sometimes meetings can be informal like that. But really, the idea of coming to a meeting with no reason is fundamentally disturbing to me. And so I have now started to say to everyone, if you're scheduling a meeting with me, please send an agenda. Tell me what you want to discuss in the meeting so that I'm prepared. Because now if someone shows up to a meeting and they have no idea what we're going to talk about, you know, I politely cancel the time. You know, I say, I'm going to take my time back and we'll meet again when you're ready to come up with a reason for meeting. And the other is, okay, now you've called a meeting. You didn't tell me what we were going to talk about. And so therefore, I'm not prepared to respond to you in the way that would be best. So let's cancel the meeting and then I will come back and be prepared the next time we meet so that we can actually have a thoughtful discussion. And I think that ends up educating people about how to productively engage in taking other people's time. And this goes back to our episode on, you know, the importance of respecting other people's time. Francis, what's your next pet peeve?
Mine is a mindset that says that most of what you're doing is wrong, or everything you're doing is wrong. That you need to change everything. And it's just not true. Most adults are not totally in the dark. They actually are doing most things correctly. And it's not a matter of trying to change everything, every tool, every habit, every practice to adhere to anything. It's more a matter of owning and feeling accomplished and starting from there. And then saying, okay, given that I'm an accomplished person and that everything I use has brought me to this level, what's the 5% I need to focus on at this point that would allow me to scale to the next level? And it's not the 95% that's wrong or bad. It's the 5%. And I remember when I discovered a word called andragogy, which has to do with adult learning, and it contrasted the what we already know about pedagogy, which is really based around the teaching of children. So when you teach math to a child, the math is brand new because they have never seen the concepts before. However, when you teach productivity to an adult, 95% of what they are doing is already working. So you can't use the same approach. You have to go back to that evaluation that we talked about before, but also you need to give the person, you need to acknowledge the fact that they are already accomplished. They've done a lot of work to develop habits, practices, and tools that work. 95% of it is positive, and the 5% is what they need to focus on. So the distinction between pedagogy and andragogy is suitable for productivity. And I can give you a link to an article on that.
I'm right there with you, Francis. I've been many years explaining to people that pedagogy is teaching people like their children, and that is not how adults learn. And as being an adult educator, you know, I don't teach children productivity, although maybe someday I will, but right now I teach adults. And so to use pedagogical approaches for adults is it's just not compatible most of the time, you know.
Sometimes it's insulting, right?
Right, absolutely. And more to the effect that there's been a lot of research on pedagogy. But when you look at andragogical approaches, there have been actually very limited numbers of those, but there's still quite a lot of information about andragogy. And so if you just Google it, you will find how to teach adults generally. And there's, you know, there's a lot of instructional design courses and so on and so forth using and being founded on pedagogical research. And that actually is quite absurd to me. You know, not that humans all don't learn in very similar ways, no matter what their age, but from a child psychology perspective, or at least from a developmental psychology perspective, you do really need to understand where people are and their abilities at each stage of the game, and that children do have limited psychological abilities, and they gain those over time. So adults, at least a normative brain, should have all of those capacities that, if you use pedagogical approaches, are actually limiting the learning process.
The whole concept to me smacks of the confusion between adult education and the concept of training. When you think about adult ed, so often we think, oh, okay, you're going to go to a training class. They're two totally different beasts. I mean, training to execute a specific task or tool or function is one thing. Going beyond that and truly understanding the core concepts and the underlying information around something is a totally different beast. So yeah, I completely agree with you guys. It's a nasty rabbit hole that will often derail people, because then they start to look at productivity concepts from a training perspective. Train me how to do this, rather than saying, help me understand how this works and how it would be useful for me.
So the next one up is Art. And so Art, take it away.
Yeah, this is a big one for me. And it dovetails with the next big thing. It dovetails with just about every system out there. When somebody takes a shot at a system or starts to work with it, and they find that there are aspects of it that they struggle with, they have a habit of declaring it doesn't work. This system doesn't work because, this tool doesn't work because, it lacks this feature, or it doesn't work the same way as this other one. Instead of backtracking it and owning that issue, this doesn't work for me because it's lacking this feature, and I need that feature because. They don't take it that far. It's easier to blame whatever the tool, the process, the solution is, than to own that and understand why that is not working for you. It's a bit of a it's a bit of navel gazing that people need to do when evaluating productivity solutions for themselves, because they have to truly understand what their need set is. But that blanket statement around a tool or a solution, especially around tools, because I see a lot of tool evaluations and follow a lot of them, and I've done them myself, and it's an easy trap to fall into. Well, it doesn't work because it doesn't offer this. You know, I'll give you a great example. You look at two tools, Evernote, OneNote. Evernote has the ability to do reminders on notes. OneNote doesn't. If you need that feature, you need one. If you don't need that feature, you can use either. But in neither case is either tool broken. It's not that they don't work. It's that they don't fit your need set. And if you don't know what your need set is, you might as well not even start the process.
And I think that's part of the big issue in this don't work or don't work for me, is that a lot of times people don't know clearly what is their issue. And I agree with you. You know, I hear, oh, well, you know, fine, you use tool X or tool Y or system X or system Y, but that doesn't work. Well, why doesn't work? Well, because, and I have even hear things like this, you know, well, it requires a lot of work. Well, but how it becomes require a lot of work means do not work. And people, for some reason, in some cases, want even instant solutions to the problems. No. You need to understand what you need and what is what you need the system of the productivity to do and how that will affect you. So, for example, for me, it's a requirement that I get geo notifications. Why? Well, because I carry a lot of things and I love the fact that when I'm going close to a place that I have marked, okay, this tool, the electronic tool remind me, hey, by the way, you know, you are here and you said you were going to do this. And then I can make the decision, yep, it's not going to happen today. Or, oh, great, I have time today, or I'm tired, or I'm in the mood, or I'm not in the mood, and I'm going to do it. And that, for me, is something important. And it's interesting to me when I talk about that, how many people say, oh, that will never work for me. That doesn't work. Well, that doesn't work for you. That doesn't, you know, another example is email. I stopped checking email on my iPhone years ago. It's not even configured. And every time I mention that and I write about that, people come back and say, oh, that doesn't work. That is impossible. That's because you do this or you do X or the kind of job you do and all this. Well, how about this doesn't work for you for whatever reason being and whatever? Some of those arguments are valid. Most of them, in my opinion, are not. But I agree. It needs to be a distinction. Doesn't work in general. All that it means is doesn't work for me. And that is fine. Then you need to figure it out what is what worked for you.
The perspective that productivity in general is experimentation, I think, is really healthy here to point out, which is that most of us, that is us on the recording and you, the listeners, I hope keep the perspective that everything you do with personal productivity over time, that which is new, is an experiment. Think like a scientist and delve into trying things and understanding that if they don't work, that's okay. Move with the cheese, as Dr. Spencer Johnson would say, and just learn to sort of ease your way into new practical solutions. And I think that's really, really helpful. Next up is Francis. Francis, what's your next pet peeve?
All right. So this one has to do with more insults, which is that don't worry, this complex set of habits and practices and tools that I'm describing to you are easy for you to use. All you need to do is, and it's a problem that I think happens in particular when we lead productivity programs, live ones. And you know, when I lead a live two-day program, and sure enough, people are all revved up by the second day. They're excited and they believe that they can go and implement everything that I told them in a flash. And I spend the better half of maybe the second day explaining and sort of talking them down from the trees to say that, okay, let's come back to ground. The fact is, you have already built up a whole sequence of habits and practices, and you're using tools that currently work for you to a major degree. Talking about changing them is way more than just talking about them. And at the end of the program, you're believing that you're Superman, but you really need to think in terms of being Clark Kent. Not that you're going to have all this time and all this focus and all this space to implement all these new behaviors all at once, but think of yourself as at your most stressed, at your most busy, with emergencies flying all over the place, and you now are trying to implement this new habit. So again, back to adult learning, most habits that are worth learning, and high performers will tell you this also, they don't come easily and they don't come instantly. So they need to be sort of parsed out over time, spread out and broken out into little baby steps. The productivity books and websites and podcasts, everything that I read sort of implies that all you need to do is understand the concept and you're good to go. And my personal experience says it doesn't work that way. And the people sort of like it when we're more real with them and tell them the truth. That, listen, you know, the odds of implementing this in your regular everyday life on a large scale very quickly are really low. Chances are you do need to focus on the smallest possible step so that you can conquer that step and build just a little momentum so that you can move to the next step. We don't spend a lot of time on that message because it sort of complicates the simplification and then it doesn't sell real well, let's call it that. Pet peeve.
Yeah, it's the tortoise or the hare. You know, most people think that the hare is the more flashy, exciting because of speed and so on and so forth. But, you know, in the end, a lot of this is a slow burn. It's slow and steady wins the race. So really enjoy that pet peeve there, Francis. Next up, Art, what's your next pet peeve?
Now we're getting into, well, I've got one more little one that I'll couple with what I was talking about earlier, which when we think about analog versus digital, in the analog world, which happens to be one of my favorite areas because I'm a big notebook pen handwriting geek, there is this battle that occurs between the minimalists in the analog world and what I call the embellishers. When you look at, if you ever want to laugh, go into Pinterest and do a search for the term bullet journal. Ryder Carroll has a great methodology. The problem is the methodology has turned into this dichotomy between the people who take it from the purest standpoint of only doing the absolute basic, and this is the way that he designed it, and this is the way it has to be done. And on the entire other end of the spectrum, the people whose notebooks look like a Hobby Lobby exploded on it with stickers and colors and diagrams and doodles and everything else. And the battle that occurs between the two. I mean, I've actually seen groups in Facebook where people will leave the groups because there's so much animosity between, no, that's too complicated, you should do it simply, or, oh my goodness, look how complicated that is, I can't do that, or, you know, vice, or there's not enough information there, it's not personal. Guys, back it down a notch. If it compels you to use the system, it is the right one. That's really all it boils down to. I'm not a doodler. I don't sit down and put stickers and things in my notebooks. It's just not me. Could I do it? Sure. Do I do it? No. Everybody makes their own decision sets. Personalize the system to match your own. And that same thing applies to digital as well. We're starting to see that more on the digital side as it grows and we have more pen-based interactions. But that dichotomy between it has to be exactly how it was defined or you should completely customize it. The answer is in the middle. It's not at either end, as is the case with so many things anymore.
As of the time of this recording, Art, we just held the third quarter discussion for Productivity Book Group on The Paradox of Choice by Barry Schwartz, and I'll put a link to it in the show notes. And a lot of what you're talking about really harkens on this idea that so many people have so many choices. But one of the problems, I think, just internally as I think about it, is this concept of racing to the margins, you know, using marginal arguments for the basis of your decisions for using something that is productive or unproductive, or identifying something as counterproductive or unproductive because of a marginal issue. And that's what it kind of sounds like to me. So I really, really appreciate that, because I think listeners will hopefully get the idea that we should really be going for the things that are going to make us and have the most effect, you know, most positive effect on our productivity. I have here Augusto. Augusto, you and I both have some discussion to have on email. So how about you start it off and I will continue it on with regard to my pet peeve connected to it.
Well, I want to start in the beginning saying email, it may be probably one of the worst communication methods that one can use. Email probably is one of the worst communication methods that one can use. That said, I understand is one that can be used, but people tend to use email and then wrote this 7-8 paragraph with a mumbo jumbo thing, and you're expecting the other person to go into your train of thought when you write it, into your mood, and understand what are the clear actions this person needs to do. You know, if you are going to use email, and you are, then you need to find a couple of things. Doesn't matter how hard is your story and how long is your story, as it is what is the clear thing that you're expecting from this person. I understand sometimes, hey, your brain, it is into writing a novel in order to ask for a copy of the paper. That is fine. But then make sure that somewhere on your email, towards the beginning of the email or towards the end of the email, there is a clear next action that you are expecting from this person. There is a clear, massive problem with email. People receive more than what they are able to process or interested in processing. And not only that, in many cases, people go get your long email, kind of skim through because they are not necessarily reading in deep, but because there is no clear next action, that thing stay there waiting for you to do a follow-up on, hey, why I never received paper X from the email I sent you last time? And then at that time is when people connect A and B and say, oh, what you were expecting out of that long mumbo-chumbo is I was going to send you paper X. So be specific on the email communication you do. That's number one when you are the sender. And send and say, hey, I need you to send me X. Doesn't matter if you feel compelled to tell a long story, at least make sure that it's clear the next action you are expecting from these people. That way, if that person read that email, there is no doubt of, oh, what they're expecting from me is this. And number two is, if you are the person receiving the email, make sure that to the best of your ability, you're not reading email more than twice. Okay, unless you like the email, in which case, fine, read it once a week, doesn't matter. The reason I stopped reading email on my iPhone was exactly that. Because I discovered I was getting distracted, reading email on the iPhone, okay, but then not doing anything because my main machine for processing information is the iPad. So I pull the iPhone, read it in there, and say, oh, yeah. Sometimes I make, you know, track stuff, move it to OmniFocus or not. But in the majority of the cases, just stay on the inbox waiting for me to get back to my iPad so I process that email. So in many cases, I read the emails twice. Sometimes I'm going to admit even more. So that way I get to the right tool and then I can process email. Email is a great tool if you use it correctly, but it's an awful master. And for most people, they are using email as a master. You go and see people and you open their inbox and they have 600, 700, 800 unread email. Okay. Forget about the ones that they already skimmed on. So my pet peeve is the misuse or the poor use of email.
I'm going to tack on to this, and I'm going to try and keep myself to as few words as possible here, because I could talk for the next hour on this subject. But I'm going to say that I believe that email is one of the greatest communications platforms ever created. However, society, culture, work culture, whatever the issues are, has created such a mechanism, such a cultural, you know, perspective that we use email for so many things inappropriately, as you kind of have detailed, Augusto. I have been very guilty of the long email, which is I would write everything I presume someone would need in order to make a decision. And going back to Dr. Tolle and Alessandra, I learned that I'm a thinker. And so I'm highly analytical. And so I would write to everybody as though everybody else was highly analytical and that they wanted all of those details. When in reality, if I start to think about the people on the other side, I can think, oh, you know what? Augusto just wants bullet points and a call to action. He wants to know what he needs to answer in order to move forward on that project. Then I can write the email in that perspective. There's a old concept of bluff, BLUF, bottom line up front. It's a very helpful mechanism, but but write your email and then take the last sentence, the last call to action, and put it right at the top of the email. And that's what people actually want to see. Sometimes I'll actually bold it. So I'll say, Dear Augusto, and then bold that action that I'm asking them. What's that call to action that I want them to do? And then everything else is fluff, in essence. It's all additional, you know, material. And this is sort of the TLDR concept that people have heard of, you know, too long, don't read. Here goes what you need to do. Here goes the brief summary of those kinds of things. But the greater problem here is when email is inappropriate, use another communication mechanism. And most often that means getting up and going and seeing that person face to face. I think that's probably the best option. That is not always an available option. My entire world is remote, you know, so I don't meet people in real life very often. So then the next option is pick up the phone, schedule a Skype call or Google Hangouts call with them so that you can see them face to face. Then make your way down the list to maybe a Slack chat or, you know, some kind of instant messaging tool or maybe SMS or something like that. But think about the appropriate communication mechanism, whether it's asynchronous, which email is, so is a voicemail message, versus synchronous, and whether or not you need to have a synchronous communication method, being live on the telephone with them, being live on instant message with them, and do that.
It's similar to the one that I have around meetings, which is that email and meetings, there's a high social component. It's very easy to abuse. Both of them are very easy to abuse. And there's very little training around how to do either of them. And I'm sort of gotten to the point where I'm despairing that there won't be any change in either email or meeting performance until there's regular feedback. And for email, what I'm hoping, my pet peeve is that hopefully one day, and why this doesn't exist, I don't know. After every email, you simply are able to or are forced to rate the quality of the communication. So what should pop up as you dismiss an email is, on a scale of 1 to 5, great message, great format, great this, great that, or terrible, don't send me anything like this again. And the same for meetings. At the end of every meeting, before everyone leaves, fill out an anonymous feedback form. And the benefit of both approaches is that the individual who sent the email and called the meeting can have aggregate feedback. If you don't want to have them get feedback to their face because of one bad email, fine, because of the social side of it. But at the end of a week, if half of the emails they sent got a very low score, it would force them to, or push them at least, to at least ask the question, well, why did I get such a low score? And then go seek out some solutions. I'm to the point where I've given up that any kind of anything other than direct feedback about these in these two areas is going to be going in one ear and out the other. So my pet peeve is that, how come we don't have this and it seems so easy to implement?
I'd be curious to know the answer to that. And so I'm going to attach my next pet peeve to this ongoing email one, because I think it's so important. And that is the one big email. And again, this goes back to my own guilt of writing those really long emails. I am so guilty of this in yesteryear, which is that I would write one very large email that covered many, many different topics, presuming that that was really efficient with my time because I sent one email. I really implore you all listening, everyone in the world, if you are sending an email and it is on multiple disparate topics, learn about the working style of the person on the other side of the email. For example, with myself, if you have 5 topics that you'd like to discuss with me, 3 are under one project and 2 are under separate projects, then you need to send me 3 email messages. Because if I'm unable to answer one of the 3 project questions or one of the 5 project questions under the 3 projects, I'm going to not be able to respond to the email necessarily. My brain kind of shuts down because I'm overwhelmed and or I'm lacking a resource to be able to fully respond to you. So that slows down 2 other projects because one item is snagging up the works. So please understand whether or not an email should be one or many email messages so that people can respond to it. Because I can respond to you know, maybe 4 of those questions if they were separate emails, but I can't respond to all of them. You know, if the three questions have one missing, then I'd respond to the two and say, I need to do more research, or I'm not quite sure how to respond to that third one yet. Well, great. Now we've moved things forward, as opposed to holding up the whole works. So just be aware of that. Okay. Any big ticket final pet peeves, gentlemen, that you want to share with our audience?
Yeah, I'll climb up my soapbox, say my piece on this one, and then get back down. My big one is the concepts of productivity versus efficiency, specifically how the two are used interchangeably, but when you think about it, they really have very little to do with each other. What you'll commonly hear is someone will say, hey, this process will make us more efficient. Therefore, we can do more. We can have more free time. That's not what efficiency is. Efficiency is literally just execution. It has nothing to do with actually being productive. And the reason why I say that is two definitions. The actual definition for the term efficiency is, if you look at it from the scientific standpoint, the accomplishment or ability to accomplish a job with minimum expenditure of time and effort. Where this falls apart is when you compare it to the definition of productivity that I use most commonly, which is doing the right things at the right time in the right way. The two have nothing to do with each other. Just because you can do something quickly does not mean you're doing the correct thing. So thinking that by improving efficiencies around existing processes will gain you the ability to add and do new things, it still has never quantified, are you actually doing what you should be doing at that point? So if you're looking at things from a productive standpoint and someone in a meeting says, oh yeah, that's going to make us more efficient, ask this question, efficient at doing what? Because if you can't qualify that question and be able to say efficient at doing something that we know is broken or efficient at doing something that we know is highly effective, then you're not getting any improvement. The productive response is, are we doing the right things at the right time in the right way? And if we are, then we will be more efficient. But efficiency does not beget productivity. Stop making that causality connection.
Preach, Brother Art. Okay, Francis, I'm going to give you the final pet peeve. Go for it.
Okay, final pet peeve is the again, goes to Clark Kent versus Superman, that we routinely underestimate how much support we need to implement new habits. So every productivity bit of advice is at its heart a behavior change. And we know that behavior changes just don't come because you say you want them. So people underestimate overestimate their willpower and underestimate the value of having a coach, for example, or reminders, or tracking their success, or developing a backup plan in case they fail. They don't think they need those things. But the fact is, we need a lot of them because we're just so unreliable. So that's my last pet peeve, is that we don't support ourselves when we try to make these behavior changes and we assume they're going to be easy. Then we're not successful and then we end up blaming someone else.
Well, I don't know about you, gentlemen, but I feel like I just had a therapy session. A productivity therapy session, in the sense that we've been able to really get so many of these pet peeves off of our chests. And so thank you so much for joining us here for another episode of Productivity Cast. We'd love to hear from you about what your number one, what your biggest productivity pet peeve is. Feel free to comment on productivitycast.net/022, episode 22. So 022 will take you there. And let us know in the comments. Let us know what your biggest productivity pet peeves are. You can also go to productivitycast.net/contact and let us know any questions that you have. And we'll be happy to answer them here on the weekly show. So thank you, gentlemen, for joining me here on Productivity Cast, the weekly show about all things personal productivity.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much.
Have a great week.
That's it for this Productivity Cast, the weekly show about all things productivity, with your hosts, Ray Sidney Smith and Augusto Pinaud, with Francis Wade and Art Gelwicks.